are here for the first time, I'm John, and I do a lot of work for WordPress. I also run a agency, Vision Communications Agency, that actually produces WordPress solutions. We do a little bit more than that, branding as well, but that's our core business. So actually, I spend a lot of time developing for WordPress, doing a little bit of support work on the forums, writing the handbooks and stuff like that. So actually, I do a lot more work doing the support documentation stuff. So I kind of get the user angle. So that's why we are having these two topics today. So the number one topic is, how do you select a good web host for your WordPress website? I'm going to focus a lot on WordPress websites, but you could use whatever I'm saying for other kind of websites as well. So these are the few things, types of hosting I'm going to talk to you about. I'm going to bust some myths that if you search online, you're going to say, don't do this and don't that. Those are usually lies. Why selecting the web host, correct web host matters? A few factors for you to consider. Now, you don't have to actually understand truly these factors or remember. And if you are actually taking a photo of this slide, don't worry, it's going to be online. And Michael here is actually recording the talk. So it's going to be online as well, so you could just view it. So just concentrate what I'm saying. So there'll be a few factors that you could look at, and you don't actually have to remember this because you could just copy and paste and send it to the web host that you want to hire or intend to look at. So number one, so busting some myths. So if you realize that a lot of web hosts out there, usually American web hosts, will say, hey, we have unlimited hard disk space, unlimited bandwidth, unlimited this and that. Now, usually, this means that they are very sure that you will never use a certain amount of space, and that's usually true. So the thing about websites is that they are usually, especially personal websites, they usually don't hit more than 2 gigabytes of space, usually. Even if you upload pictures and stuff like that, you maybe hit about 5 gigabytes, you'll never hit anything above that. So having unlimited disk space doesn't do you any justice. And the thing about unlimited anything with hosting is that they're likely going to restrict you somewhere in places that you cannot see, like RAM usage, CPU, or things like that. So when people go to a website, they find it loading very slowly, and then you can't complain about it because they're not doing anything wrong. They're still giving you everything unlimited. But really, the things that matter, they are not giving you that. So don't go for things that they say unlimited, because the shortfall needs to come from somewhere. So any host will do. If you Google a good web host, there's likely going to be a lot of big names. But the thing about WordPress is that, and this is usually in the local context, a lot of web hosts don't actually want to support WordPress. Now, why is this? There's so many people using WordPress, and then they have so little support staff. When they have a WordPress issue, they talk to the host, and they get a little bit upset. Yeah, so things like that. Because in the end, you're paying them about $10, $15 a month. Yeah, they can't really push on their hosts, their support staff to keep supporting WordPress people. Now, which is why you should choose a host that specifically says, hey, we love WordPress. Then you're going to get all your problems solved for you without having to spend a single sum. So, and sometimes when you go for a cheap hosting plan, and you get trotted because there's a lot of traffic. You wrote a very, viral piece of blog article. So a lot of people is visiting your website, and suddenly you see your website go down. It's not reachable, or it just looks really slow. This is because your host is throttling you, and then they will likely tell you that, hey, you need a dedicated server. So instead of paying about $15 a month, you start paying about $100. Yeah. So usually that's not the case. Yeah. So I'm going to show you why later. And sometimes you get a message from your web host saying, we're upgrading you to cloud. And cloud is a very fake term. Yeah. So and you should always ask what they're doing to upgrade you to cloud. What are they changing? Are they downgrading? Anything like that? So with one of my clients, I've moved them, I think nearly all of them off to my servers. But before that, we had this client that actually got moved to the cloud, but actually they reduced the RAM usage by half. And then their site was perfectly fine, but started going to errors and stuff like that because there's no RAM to use. Yeah. And then a lot of times hosts like to say, it's WordPress, it's not us, our servers are perfectly fine, which is sometimes true, but usually not. Yeah. So, this is just a comparison of what I said just now. So, most web hosts will give you a specific number, 50 gigabyte of space, 200 GB traffic, some email accounts and stuff like that. So you're thinking, you're looking at this, hey, 99 email accounts, great, I love that. But the truth is, you're never going to use more than 5 email accounts, especially for your own private site. You're never going to need unlimited web space because the upload speed is usually so slow. You're going to spend time uploading things. So you're just going to upload things that matter to your website. You're not going to upload your private video collection and stuff like that. Yeah, you're just going to upload your photos and your blog posts and stuff like that. So, and they're going to say unlimited or 99 MySQL databases. But the truth is, WordPress only uses one database, so that's only one that you need, one. Yeah, so when comparing the web hosts, don't just look at the numbers here, because these are the numbers that don't truly matter. These are the numbers that you never exceed. 50 gigabyte, never seen a client actually exceed that. And even with the WordPress.org website, the database itself, it serves millions of users per month. I can't remember the exact number, but that's about 4 gigabytes of space, yeah, just about the database. And we don't actually upload a lot of files, a lot of photos and stuff like that. So when you actually select a web host, I think one of the things that... actually, how many people here has a WordPress website? Yeah, that's great. So if you select a web host and actually your plugin page looks like this, this is an old, I just took over this site recently. If your plugin page looks like this, then might not be the web host being the issue, might be you. Then I'll cover this a little bit about selecting correct WordPress plugins, but typically it should not look like this. You should not have 50 plugins trying to run your site. Yeah. So then if you search through Google, you'll likely find a lot of articles that say, hey, WordPress is using too much memory on my host because the host is throttling your account and stuff like that. Usually caused by plugins. Yeah, so that's a good way to check whether this plugin, there's this plugin called the P3, the Plugin Performance Profiler. So you can run it and it will basically tell you which plugin is actually taking a lot of time or memory space, taking a lot of memory, taking a lot of CPU time, things like that that helps you understand. And it's actually a graph that shows you, okay, which ones are taking up too much memory. So then you could look for a plugin that takes less memory. Or maybe not use this plugin at all, maybe you don't need it, yeah. So those are the myths, and I'm going to cover the types of hosting that you can select from. So shared hosting, managed hosting, virtual private servers are what I'm going to concentrate on, because if you go to a dedicated servers, you likely need to talk to a developer. You have special needs, and this is not really a place to cover that. And cloud hosting, like I said, is a very big term. Cloud hosting can be a cloud shared hosting. It could be a cloud managed hosting. So I'm just going to omit this because it's a very big term. If someone tells you they do cloud hosting, ask them whether they are doing the first three. Yeah. So type of hosting. Thing about hosting is that they all run through a physical server, so they're all here. And when you use a shared hosting, and usually these plans range about the Singapore web host about $10 to $20, you are one of the tiny users in the server. Yeah, so and the thing is, they could put about 80 minimum to about 400 websites on one server. Yeah, so the bad point about this is that if one of those websites start to spam, then you start to realize that emails get bounced, or they take up all the server's CPU and memory usage, and your website is not reachable as well. So that's the risk of using a shared host. Now, VPSs are more like virtual servers. They run on top of a actual physical server. So people get to control their own server. So if anything goes wrong with server number one, server number two doesn't get affected. So that's a virtual private host. And of course, a dedicated server is actually the physical server itself. Yeah. So I'm going to show you a little bit of what shared hosting is. This is usually the case about shared hosting. Everyone is squeezed into one server. And the positive part is that it's really cheap. Yeah, it's easy to start with. If you use the one-click setup via Fantastico, you could do that, which is actually a bad point because the one-click setup via Fantastico is actually pretty shitty. Yeah. So cons, there's no SSL, and if you have been to our previous meetup, you know that SSL actually contributes to better search engine optimization. Of course, it secures your website, so if you log in through your WordPress backend, And you're using a public Wi-Fi, you will not get a password stolen. That's important. It's usually terrible support with shared hosts. Just imagine this number of people inside one server, and they have dozens, hundreds of servers in a data center. So when these people call, they're going to give you simple copy-pasted one-liners. Yeah, all they're going to tell you, we don't support WordPress, it's the third-party script. So that's the real issue with shared hosting. The performance is usually quite terrible. So, but if you do need to use shared hosting, at a later part, I'm going to cover specifically when you should use which hosting. If you do want to use shared hosting, you must make sure that, number one, they allow you to select the PHP version. So this is key. Why? Because actually just today, PHP version 5.5, now you don't have to remember this number, but basically PHP is what runs your WordPress website, which is also what PHP conference is about. Yeah, and today PHP 5.5 got deprecated, meaning that there's no security support, no nothing. So a lot of these web hosts who are still running the old versions are actually insecure. So you could spend a year, many years writing your website, and one day, because you forgot to back up, you get hacked. Not because it's your fault. You've used a perfect theme, you've used a perfect plugin, you even got a developer to look through it. But the server is insecure. Then you get hacked. Now, this is really a problem with shared hosts. Why? Because they've got 200 websites in one server. They can't update a specific module just to please you. This is really tough. Yeah. And as you notice the dates, in a year, the next version, in about a year, the security support, or 2 years, ends support. Then again, that version will become insecure. So it is essential that if you use a shared host, that they allow you to select the PHP version. Yeah. So you could just ask them, send me, you know, am I allowed to select my PHP version, or are you on an unsecure one? Because I recently moved the client side, which is this really scary one. They were on a server that had PHP 5.2. I think that was security support was off about 5 years ago. Anyway, so back to the this. So the few specs that you could ask for, are they running SSD, solid-state drive? So servers use hard disk as well. And solid-state drives are actually much, much faster. Yeah. So if you ask them, do they use this? You can guarantee that your files will be served much faster. That's one. You could ask them whether they have enough RAM allocation. So typically for WordPress, you need at least 128 MB RAM. Yeah. And if they don't even have that, don't bother going with the shared hosting. They need to be able to tell you that you can at least reach to 128 MB. And server segregation, is the mail server and web server separated? Now, this is important if you get a web hosting account and you use their web services, sorry, their mail services. So you don't want to be sending out email to people and actually your mails are getting blocked because they are recognized as spam. Now, this is an issue because it's so easy to write a simple script or write to a simple website that's designated to send spam emails. I'm sure you guys have Gmail accounts and check the spam folder. It's full of Viagra Today, Mail Order Brides, random stuff like that. Now, these are what's coming out of random servers in the world. So it is safer for you to have a mail and a web server separated. Yeah. So this is something you can ask your web host when you're looking through them. Now, I was telling you just now that actually that if you over if you have a lot of plugins installed, or you've written a viral blog article and a lot of people visit you, this could be a page that people see or you yourself see because they have locked up your site because you've used too much resources. Now, to be fair, if they have about 200 customers on that single server, and your single website is locking up the entire server, they're going to just block you first to solve the situation for the rest of the 199. So this is both an advantage and disadvantage. You know at least for sure that if someone is doing something weird, eventually they will block their site. Yeah, maybe after a few hours. Yeah, but your site will become like this, and it's not great. Yeah. So I was saying just now that you could have 128 MB of RAM at least, and if you can ask them whether they use run the Nginx web server, it's going to use a lot less RAM than, say, Apache. And for shared hosting, make sure that in terms of services, they do not say they do not support WordPress. Now, if they say that, don't bother writing putting up a WordPress website on them, no matter how cheap they are. And I can tell you, if you Google today, you could find a dollar hosting. You might be able to find even free hosting, but they will likely put a footer in your website saying that they support you with free hosting, and then your website actually loads after 20 seconds, stuff like that. Make sure they have auto backups. You'll be surprised that actually, because a lot of web hosts to cut costs, they don't do auto backups. And I imagine at least half of you guys in here don't actually back up your site. Then when your site actually gets hacked into or gets or crashes and stuff like that, you don't have any backups left. Yeah. And also, it is quite important, just in case, when you do install new plugins or new themes or update your WordPress version, that you should do your own manual backup. Now, the thing about some hosts is that they will actually disable this because it takes up a lot of CPU speed. So when they disable this, they can squeeze in more people into one server, but this actually puts you at a disadvantage. So make sure you ask them whether you can do these manual backups. So the thing about shared hosting is that you never know who you're hosting with. It could be on someone's desktop computer. I have a 1 gigabyte line at home. I could very well host you, and it would be okay-ish. Yeah, but the day I switch off my computer is the day your site goes offline for good. Yeah. So, and you will never know, because I could run a free Linux box from home from as cheap as $300 or $400. No issues. Yeah. I think I can run a Pi 3 computer for about $50. Yeah. As a web server. So shared hosting, you sort of run into this risk, because I could set up a very genuine name. Well, my company's Wingz Communications, I can say Wingz Hosting Services and so on. And actually, it's just one server, one computer running all this. It could also be someone who buys a reseller account on a web host, and he doesn't actually know how to be a host. He just sells you the hosting. This is a huge risk with shared hosting. So thing about shared hosting is that unless you're super tight for money, basically don't use it. Yeah, because in the end, with shared hosting, they are expecting you to pay upfront for 1 whole year. Yeah, so if you pay upfront for 1 whole year, you're pretty much screwed over for at least $200 anyway. So for managed WordPress hosting, and this is the kind of a newish term over the 1 or 2 years, managed hosting itself is actually quite new too, actually. When you do manage WordPress hosting, it's actually they install WordPress for you. You don't have to do anything. I think someone's asking me just now. All you need to do is log in the WordPress backend, install the plugins and the themes that you want. Everything else, anything that goes wrong with your site, even the cache issues and so on, they will handle it for you. And usually this is not that much more expensive than shared hosting. Yeah. So the good things about managed WordPress hosting is that there's a lot higher resources available to you. More RAM, more CPU, which means you can install more plugins, a more fanciful site. You might be able to, actually you can, run an e-commerce website now if you want to sell things. Super easy to start with. You basically just sign up and you click a button and you can install WordPress. Don't need to understand any tech things at all. And the good thing is, because they are so in tune with WordPress, usually they're in tune with team members of WordPress, they will stay up to date. So you never have to worry whether the server is out of date or it is insecure. And they will help you push automatic WordPress updates. And whenever these updates somehow go wrong because they did something weird, they'll fix it for you. This is a really great thing with managed hosting. The not so good thing is that it's maybe twice the monthly cost. But twice the monthly cost will be from $10 to $20. Yeah. So this is still not really a big money for a website, actually. And you likely cannot use anything other than WordPress. Now, if you're thinking about installing a CRM system that's not WordPress, installing about maybe a chat system that's not WordPress, you can. Probably you can. So for managed WordPress hosting, what you should look out for is that support. Are they actually offering you support to fix your website issues? Now, usually they do, but it's good to ask. Do they have SSL? And so far, the few WordPress managed hosting companies that I like offer free SSL through Let's Encrypt. So if you have been to one of our meetups recently, we talked about Let's Encrypt, which is a free SSL cert. It used to cost about $100+ a month, not a month, a year. If they also offer auto backups, now cache control is important, because when you update, say, a plugin or a new theme, or you push in a new article, they should automatically clear the cache so that your users will see the updated content. So cache control is important because some of these managed WordPress hosts, they will actually aggressively cache your website. So no matter how much you refresh, you don't see the updated content. It looks okay to you, but it doesn't look okay to the rest of the world. So they need to allow you to control this. Auto-scaling is important. So like I'm saying that if you write a viral piece of article and suddenly 5 to 10, 100,000 people visit you, they will scale up your systems, allow more traffic to come in, save you for a while, and get your article to be read. Now, this is usually not the case with shared hosting. They will just block you. Some managed WordPress hosts to save, because not all themes and plugins are created the same. Some of them are just very resource intensive. Some of them are just not coded securely. So they might have restrictions on certain plugins they like, certain plugins they don't like. And do they offer migration service? This is not just into WordPress or into their service, it's also out as well. So make sure they don't lock you down and say, sorry, you can't get out of our hosting service, or you need to pay us another $300 so we can perform this migration service. Ask them upfront if they you need to pay anything. And more importantly, if you ever get to the stage where you actually think, hey, I can become a professional right now through this website, I'm selling great things, or I'm writing great articles, you could check whether they have SSH access. Don't need to understand what this is, but this is actually command line. So if you do hire a developer and developer asks you, do you have SSH access? You can ask, you can give them an account and they can log in and fix anything for you through a command line. Yeah. So the last thing I'm going to cover for various type of hosts is virtual private server. So a virtual private server is actually a virtualization service on top of a physical server. Now, don't have to wonder what it is, but if you have used Mac and then you realize that for a long time now, you have been allowed to install Bootcamp. Not exactly the same, but almost like that. So you have one on top of the other. So you install Bootcamp, you can run Windows inside the Mac itself. Or if you install Parallels, you can run Windows inside the Mac itself. So it kind of works like that in, not theory, but for at least layman's term. The good thing about this is that it's super customizable. So if you decide that I want a special cache, I read through an article and it tells me I should install memcache or I should install opcache, things like that, to speed up my WordPress website, you can follow the article, type this command, put it inside, type this command and put it inside, and it will work. And the thing about that is that actually when I started out the hosting, setting up my own servers, I also follow articles like that. Because now I'm a little bit more advanced than that. But those articles are around, and if you're a little bit more tech inclined, you could follow those articles and create a virtual private server. Of course, you still need to get someone to host it for you, and the cheapest go for about $10. No, actually $5, so maybe $7 or $8. It could go as expensive as $100 or $200 as well, kind of depends. But you could get it really cheap. And even if you go for the really cheap one, this is about 5 to 10 times better than shared hosting. Of course, you've got to set up everything yourself. You could run other web systems such as VoiceChat if you play games and you use things like Mumble, or use things like Ventrilo. You can install chat services. Anything that can be installed on Linux, you could probably install it on a VPS. It's the best cost to performance ratio. Like I said, $5 to $10 USD, you could run a virtual private server. The concept, you probably need to be or hire a system admin. Yeah. And the cost varies. So like the same specs in Singapore to get a virtual private server in the usual web host is about $100. Yeah. But the same specs in US through some of the big VPS sellers, they sell about $5 to $10. And the thing is, usually no support. Yeah. So if anything goes wrong with your virtual private server, they don't care. So what to look out for? Data center location. This is important. If you want your site to be fast in Singapore, they should have a data center in Singapore. Physical specs, the CPU, the RAM, and whether they're using SSD. Now, usually nowadays, VPS start off around 1 gigabyte of RAM, which is plenty for WordPress website. Like I said, WordPress websites, usually your typical blog will not hit more than 128 MB RAM. usually around, if you're using Apache, about 40, 50 MB RAM. So 1 GB is plenty. You probably can run quite a few websites. Check whether they have IPv6 support. Now, again, these are things that you don't have to remember. Just ask them. If you have IPv6 support, you're better protected for the future. So now I'm going to cover when do you use which hosting. So shared hosting, you have less traffic, around 50 to 100 users, not concurrently, just think about maybe per day in total. If 50 to 100 users concurrently, they'll probably block you already on shared hosting. Nothing on the site is critical. You're okay with losing it. Yeah. You're not intending to earn money, and you're not going to handle transactions. Because you're going to handle transactions, usually through credit card, you need SSL and a little bit more than that. Even if you use PayPal, they might not necessarily trust your site at all, because if I don't see a green lock on top of the website bar, which shows that it's secure, I'm not going to put in my card number on your site. When you use managed WordPress hosting, when you have decent traffic, think about 500 to 1,000 users per day. I think this covers more about emerging bloggers. Yeah, so they will likely have that amount of people. I think if you have a blog like Xiaxue, it's about 50k per day minimum. So that's not going to work as well. This should be important to you. I like this site. It's important to me. Or it's my company website. Go ahead and use the managed WordPress hosting. Because this is the case where, especially if you're a marketing manager or things like this, your boss says, hey, go get us a website. I think you're tech-savvy enough to set something up. You go for managed WordPress hosting, you charge the hosting to your company, and then you don't have to worry about support because the WordPress host will support you. And the key thing about this is that I should mention it to you that if you are a Singapore company, you could use PIC to offset your hosting costs. Yeah. If you are going to handle transactions, and more importantly, scaling or worldwide latency is not important. So if you have a website that's hosted in the States, there's likely going to be like a 0.5 seconds or a little bit less than that difference in page speed. Not because your site is slow, but because there's a great distance between the server and you. Yeah. So if you have worldwide people, then likely you need worldwide servers in the entire world, or load balancers. But if it's not important, don't worry. Just have one specific managed WordPress hosting account, and you'll be go. So use a VPS or a managed VPS. If you have very high traffic, think 2,000 users and above. Scaling is important. The good thing about VPSs is that usually with a click of a button, you can create a load balancer. For example, my VPS is in Singapore. All the Singaporeans load it super fast. It loads my website super fast. And then I realized that someone in Germany doesn't get it fast. Now, I could then say, hey, you have a data center in Germany. Could I replicate this thing and then set up a load balancer in Germany? And people who access your website suddenly realize, hey, it's much faster now in Germany as well. So usually with this, with the great VPS host, it's a one-click button kind of a thing. You need other systems to be installed. And nowadays, actually, a lot of web services are multiple, not just one system. So it's not just WordPress. So WordPress can connect with other CRM systems and stuff like that. And if you want it all installed in one server, go for a VPS. If you are also just a techie person, you want to manage the configurations exactly how you want, go for a VPS as well. Like I said, if you need to use a dedicated server, you'll know it, and likely you have to speak to a developer anyway. So this is just a little bit of an example. So this is actually one of my clients' website. So you can see that by default, if you optimize the server well, it's only using 1% of the server's resources, just 1%. So WordPress by itself actually doesn't do a lot, doesn't take up a lot of RAM, doesn't take up a lot of CPU. But that's provided you go for a specific host tailored to your needs. So anyway, to conclude the hosting talk, I think the idea is that you have a personal website that you don't really need to think about. Just go for a shared host as a start. If you can shell a little bit of a dough, go for managed WordPress hosting, because those usually charge you monthly. they don't expect you to pay $200 a year, and then you are stuck with them for an entire year. Think about also shared hosting services is that usually they will say that, okay, this is not out of our support agreement. They're going to charge you on average about $107, the $7 being GST, to provide services. Yeah. This is usually the case. So that's all for the hosting talk. Follow up will be the plugin talk, but I'm going to give you a little bit of a break. But before that, is there any questions? You can ask about your own website, what should I use, and so on, no issues.
You want
to talk
about WordPress.com as well?
Sure, okay. Anyone understands the difference between WordPress.com and WordPress.org? Dylan will understand, yes. Okay, so WordPress.com is a commercial space. Kind of like, imagine, anyone use LiveJournal before? Or use Blogger? Stuff like that. So they are a service that also provides free WordPress blogs. Yeah, because you can use it a little bit more than blogs as well. So WordPress.com is that. It's a commercial service. Yeah. And then of course, when you grow and then you decide that I want to pay professional people, you could hire people within their list of clients. But WordPress.com is actually an intricate setup with many, many, and we're talking about hundreds of servers. And they're using the WordPress multi-site system. So not really comparable to what you would use as well. And they have a lot of load balancers as well. So when you access a WordPress.com site, you can get the same seat everywhere in the world.
No, I mean like as a user, like why would they use WordPress.com instead of like shared hosting?
Yes, yeah. So I was talking to someone just now about that. So if you are starting out and you think, hey, I'm not really interested in being a host, I'm not interested in, I still don't know whether WordPress is the right solution for me, go ahead and go on to WordPress.com because it allows you to just register for a new account. It gives you most of the possibilities you would have with WordPress itself. So you are allowed to install a few, the themes, there are about 50 themes that you could choose from, but more than good enough for a personal website. And you get to post articles and things like that. There are some plugins that you can use, for example, Jetpack. That allows you to create actually a proper website. So even with a free WordPress.com account, you could use that to create a proper personal website. Maybe even a business site if you actually try hard enough. Yeah. So the use case would be you're not ready to pay any money to a web host, and maybe you're not sure that you need a website. Go ahead and try WordPress.com and you can test it out. And that's actually a tiny little bit of experience of what WordPress can do for you. WordPress has around 43,000 plugins that allows you to do whatever you want. The biggest e-commerce platform is actually powered by WordPress. Yeah. So when you do decide after you're done with the WordPress.com free service, you say, hey, now I need a website. Go ahead, maybe get a managed WordPress hosting. Set up your own WordPress website, and then you can install any plugin, anything that you want. Yeah, does that cover what you want to ask? Anyone else have any questions? Yes, that is a tough process. But usually, when you move from .com.org, you only can move the articles and the posts and the media files and stuff like that. You can't move the actual design. You have to sort of recreate the designs. Yeah, but the good thing about that is that the WordPress.com ones, you don't actually do a lot about design. You select a theme, you're sort of done with it. Yeah, and usually what you need is just the content. Yeah, so there's actually WordPress has an import and export function. You can just export all the data you need into one single file. That file, when you set up your own WordPress website, just import it. It's that simple. Yeah.
Yeah. How do you compare this to cloud hosting like AWS or
Google Cloud? Yeah, so AWS offers, I think there were 50 different services. Yeah, so if you are talking about the standard, say maybe S3 or anything like that, AWS has a higher learning curve. Yeah, so if you want to set up anything with AWS, you sort of need to know what you're doing because they have Lambda, they have S3, they have 50 other various services that I really don't really know which ones does what.
AWS, yeah. The most basic one is the EC2, which is your
VPS. The E2, right?
Exactly,
yeah.
VPS.
Yeah. So you can, if you get an E2 instance, but the thing is,
EC2.
The EC2 instance, you could pretty much set up like a VPS. No difference from Linode, no difference from DigitalOcean, Rackspace.
It's
and,
a bit more complicated because they require you to know like SSH keys and all that. Whereas DigitalOcean, you can, there's this web terminal thing which you can go into and explore.
I think you should not use that, it's terrible actually. Yeah.
Yeah, but
yeah.
It's,
yeah, they
it's
do. But that's actually for, that's actually for what you call that, emergency cases when you actually lock yourself off SSH. Yeah.
Database, you
But if you're asking how does it compare, I think it compares in a way that AWS, there are so many other services that you can connect to. Yeah. So, but with VPS, if you need to say create a storage service like S3, you need to create it yourself instead of just subscribing to the S3 storage. Yeah, things like that. If only we were at AWS today, they can, then we could have someone to answer you that specific question. But in the next, likely, next, I think maybe in September or October, we will be back at likely AWS again. So feel free to catch one of the Amazon Web Services people and they will tell you, explain to you exactly why. No, actually, WordCamp itself, there will be AWS people there. So, you know, talk to them. Yeah. Yeah, there is.
It's quite easy to set
up the stack and the WordPress. Yes. Actually, yeah. Yeah, there's no cPanel. You could pay for a cPanel license and install it yourself as well. Then you have cPanel, but then why? Why would you do that? You might as well just get a managed VPS. Yeah. But if you actually go for VPS, doesn't matter, AWS or anything like that, you need to know, you need to know command line. That's just that. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so any other questions? Okay, great. So if you want to talk to me one-to-one about any questions you have, that's fine as well. So let's have a 5 minutes break. The plugin talk should be slightly shorter. And then be back here about 8:25. Yeah, thank you.
There's still more pieces outside.